Welcome to the afternoon session of this conference. And in this second session, we are going to speak about regulatory issues, and that is very, very interesting because we have a lot of colleagues from the regulatory authority, MHH. So welcome. And I'd kind of like to ask everybody, my colleagues and the other participants as well, to ask questions. So we are here to discuss, and we don't want this conference to be formal. So we would like to have an air of independence, and we would like you to address the experts who are sitting at this table. But first, let me ask, before I give the floor to Mr. Adrian White, our keynote speaker today, let me ask Mr. András Koltai to introduce the members of this afternoon panel.
Köszönöm. A technikai információ a bemutatás előtt, hogy az előző szekcióhoz képest két sávossá vált a tolmácsolás, tehát az egyik hangsávon jön a magyar, a másikon az angol, úgyhogy kérem, hogy így használják a készülékeket. A panel résztvevői részben már délelőtről ismertek. Geyer Balázs a szélére főszerkesztők fórumától, mellette Nyakas Levente a Médiatudományi Intézet vezetője, média jogász, mellette Áncos Petra, a Pázmány Péter Katolikus Egyetem adjunktusa, Európa jogi szakértő, mellette Joan Barata úr, az EBSZ sajtószabadság képviselőjének főtanácsadója, szintén a médiával foglalkozó szakértő, mellette pedig akárcsak az előző panelben is szakmaasszony, jogi és szabályozási szakértő. A panel moderátora ezúttal Ocskó György lesz majd.
Köszönöm. And before I give the floor to Aidan, I would like to repeat it again, that all the materials and all the information from today will be uploaded on this dedicated website, so please consult our website to have more information of today's conference. Thank you, and Mr. White, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much indeed. There's always a danger when you're the first speaker after lunch, and everyone is having a particularly good lunch. So I hope that at least if you are going to have a nap, I might wake you up once or twice during it. I also agree with the idea that this is an interactive discussion, and it would be great to hear the views from the floor. Perhaps I can begin with saying a few words about what I'm doing and who I am. I'm the director of the Ethical Journalism Network. When I left my last job, which was the General Secretary of the International Federation of Journalists, I decided that to really focus the period of this last period of my working life on not on the issue specifically of the future of journalism, finding new market models, not on the issue of innovation, being excited by the technology and how we use it and so on, and not on the issue of the converged media and the new newsrooms and so on, but actually on something really fundamental, which is as important as when I started in journalism 45 years ago as it is today, and that is the question of content, the question of the quality of the content. Because the quality of the content and the information that we put out and we receive is at the very heart of all of this discussion. And therefore, the Ethical Journalism Network, I'm working with a number of colleagues, including colleagues here in Hungary, I'm happy to say, right at the outset a couple of years ago, was set up really to focus on this really sort of very simple but straightforward question about how do we build a respect for ethics, good governance, and self-regulation. And we are a coalition of media professional groups from Europe and around the world, see about what we're doing on the Ethical Journalism Network site and so on. We take our inspiration for the work that we're doing from really the traditions of what we mean by ethics in journalism and the quality of journalism. And they're based upon an understanding of human rights, respect for human rights, but also flows from the human rights base, both here in Europe and internationally, is the notion of media freedom and free expression. And if we can say that the European Convention of Human Rights is a sort of, or the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a sort of code of conduct for humanity about how we ought to behave to one another and how society should be organized, then the codes of journalism and the standards set out in journalism are equally important in trying to define the basis on which journalists work and how they should work. And there's nothing new about this debate. It's been going on for years and years and years. The first code of conduct was drafted in sort of the 1850s by an editor of the Times. The first one that was really sort of put into effect came around 1917. The first international one was really sort of effectively put together in 1952. So there are about 400 in place now, and they cover everything. All sort of cultures, traditions, and so on. So we've been very good over the years in writing down how we would like ourselves to behave. We've been very good at that, and I think that's a very good, important sort of tradition. But what we don't think in our network is that necessarily we have to rewrite everything we've said in the past just to sort of adjust to new conditions. We do have to recognize we have to update a certain amount of guidelines and so on, and that really is an important piece of work which we are engaged in, and we have discussions with groups like the Council of Europe, groups like the OSCE and the agencies of the United Nations to talk about how we do approach regulation and self-regulation in the new environment. At the beginning, I want to sort of really get back to a question that came up this morning, and that is, you know, who is a journalist? Because it always seems to me that we have to sort of not so much ask the question, who is a journalist, but ask the question, what is journalism? Because I think that is a much more important question. And I begin by always making it clear, because there's a lot of confusion about this, even within the industry, is that ethical journalism is not free expression. That is to say, it is constrained expression. It works in a framework of values. It has purpose. It is a public good. And it's what distinguishes journalism from the free expression commentary that we have all around us these days. A lot of people say journalism is dead, we're all publishers these days, you know, because we have access to technology, does not at all constitute a journalistic activity. You can open up your computer. As a citizen, you can say what you want. You can be decent or indecent. You can be honest or dishonest. You can tell lies. You can pretend to be somebody else. You can be offensive. You don't have to worry about hurting people's feelings. And you never have to say sorry, because you don't have to be accountable. Providing you don't break the law, and there are a few laws you can break, you've got pretty much the scope to say whatever you want. And actually, that's freedom of expression. It's liberating, it's important, it strengthens our democracy, but it's not journalism. Journalism is constrained expression. The notion of journalism being a license to say whatever you want, however you want it, is absolutely offensive to the traditional understanding inside journalism of what journalism should be. It's the starting point, it seems to me, for a proper debate and dialogue with all of the groups that should be represented in this discussion about the future, about how we are going to regulate ourselves in the future. So, the values that constrain journalism the expression of opinions, analysis, commentary, background on events that is not subject to notions of propaganda, defending solely a particular interest, outlining opinion, whether it's political or commercial or whatever. So independent expression is important. Impartiality, the idea that there are more than one side to the story, that other people's views have to be taken into consideration, the notion of inclusivity in journalism, impartiality. But fourthly, humanity. We can have an argument about this as well. But humanity is a question of how do we respect the audience? We have to be aware that our images, the images we use, the words that we use, can do damage. They can do serious damage. Not far from here, over the recent decades, they have done terrible and horrifying damage. Media have played a terrible role in fomenting conflict, leading to terrible acts of violence. Next year will be the 20th anniversary of the Rwandan genocide, in which media played an integral part in horrible atrocities which were committed by community against community. So the point is that our humanity is about our respect for the audience, being aware of the consequences of what we publish. And finally, and it's the most difficult thing for journalists, is the question of accountability, saying sorry when we make our mistakes. And also, engaging with the audience, being ready to discuss with the audience what we're doing and how we're doing it. So accountability is important. Now, the other constraints that we have in this period I just outlined a couple of them here. We referred to this morning the question of the changing industry. That is really a fundamental change. The political and social challenges. In the political sphere, there is a deeply embedded culture of a sense of ownership about media, and particularly public media. That where politicians, when they get into government, have a sense that this is our moment to ensure that the channels of communications with our constituency, our public, are reflecting our opinions and so on. This is absolutely contrary to principles of democracy and so on. So there are political and social challenges. The internet is probably the greatest challenge, though, at the moment, because one of the biggest challenges that we have in journalism is to tell our stories in context. As I've said, truth, independence, impartiality. But the rush to publish, which was highlighted this morning, constrains this. The rush to publish, the notion of clicks over content as being the driving force for how we engage with the audience, is causing massive problems. And it's not just a problem that it takes a little bit of time to correct errors and so on. Last year there was a story, I don't know if you remember it, called The Innocence of Muslims, where it's a story about a film that was published, The Innocence of Muslims. It's a brief video, 12 minutes on YouTube, producer. The Associated Press did a story about this film. They said, it's produced by a Jewish film director. They said he had $5 million given to him by 100 Jewish benefactors in order to produce a piece of propaganda against Islam and against the Muslim community. They ran the story. It wasn't true. He wasn't a Jewish film director. He hadn't received $5 million. He was an extremist Christian from Cairo. He borrowed $50,000 from his mum. He produced an amateurish film. The consequences of that story were it was picked up by extremists around the world, demonstrations, Karachi, Cairo, and so on. 73 people killed. The Associated Press put out a correction, a lengthy correction, 48 hours later. Too late. Much too late. By this time, the story had done its terrible damage. So the rush to publish is not is a critical issue, and in which we have to question those who say that the principle of immediacy, being as fast as possible, is actually counter to the intuitive sense of quality and ethics and so on. And that is a major question for how we deal with it. So how is this new environment looking? This is the new structure. Basically, it's very straightforward. We have here online. We have media bloggers, people like just journalists during the day, they write their own blog. So we have publishers, we have broadcasters, we have advertisers, we have all. And then we have the audience as content providers. And then we have the audience as consumers. Now they're content providers and they're consumers. And actually they're part of the distribution process as well. Because media are always looking for the thumbs up sign for a story. Because actually that encourages more clicks. More clicks, more clicks. The more of these you get, the more advertisers and sponsors you get. So consequently, the competition for this is very strong. So we have to sort of see the consequences of it, are that we are in the world that we're living in, is that internet as a source of news, as we said this morning, is now clearly going up. This was in 2008 in the United States, where we saw internet going as a source of news. People go to the internet before they go to newspapers. Actually, it's not quite overtaken broadcasting yet, but it's on the way. Although I have to say, this important fact shouldn't be misunderstood. Because most of the internet sites where people go to get their news are traditional media. 17 of the 25 largest news portals in the United States are traditional media. It's the traditional media that has actually now found itself and created for itself largely the controlling share of the internet news market. So the reality is that although people are using technology to, in a different way, they're no longer buying a newspaper, they're no longer turning on the radio, they're increasingly going straight to the internet, when they get there, they're going to the branded trademarks that they have seen before. The largest single news site in the world is, I regret to say, the Daily Mail. The Daily Mail in Great Britain, which is a populist newspaper, is far and away the biggest single internet news site in the world. So we have a new structure, and we're seeing a generation of changing culture. And I referred to this morning, this new generation is changing because of the way that their habits. They're also changing how they want to see the news. And some media are responding quite well to it. We have a completely new sort of approach. But one of the things we have to, first of all, when I want to go back to the question of audiovisual services. This change market, where we have the converged media market, we have text, audio, video, online, all together working in the same newsroom, means that audiovisual services and public broadcasting are just one brick in the wall. They're not some charmed, special area that needs to have special consideration and is specially looked after. Because we have a new wall of information which is available. Part of it is public service broadcasting, but actually there are also other parts of it which are equally potentially public service media. So the single occupier of the public service media space is no longer audiovisual services, although it must be said that television is still important. But one of the things that television can do is it can innovate. And here's an example, the changing culture of journalism. One third of Americans under 40, it's important to say that under 40, they say that The Daily Show with Jon Stewart is replacing traditional news outlets. They still want to have news. They want to know what's going on, but they want to see it very much and hear about it in their own context. The old framework, the old institutions that we have had as information factories, broadcasting, print, producing information, which is controlled and, as it's now said, curated and organized by media professionals, is no longer satisfactory. They're looking for a completely different approach. So we see this different approach, and at the same time we see the decline, which was referred to this morning, traditional journalism in decline. And that has produced, and there's no question about it, a democratic deficit. And I think, therefore, I don't think you can escape the question of what crisis are we in? Are we in a crisis of regulation? Or are we in a crisis of falling access migration by citizens, and therefore a demographic deficit. In Europe, cutbacks have reduced the news industry considerably. It's down 30% in the United States just since 2000. In almost every single country, we see the number of jobs, viable jobs in journalism, absolutely reduced. The working conditions of journalists, absolutely reduced. Less training in journalism, less investment in research time, less investigative journalism. Absolutely, all of this has had a corrosive effect on the ability of journalism and media to function. So we therefore have to look at what are the consequences of that. The consequences of that is that we see the public information space is now not occupied just by the old familiar groups. It's now occupied by new players who are potentially dangerous in terms of the democracy that we want to see. For example, I would say that there are sort of four large groups in the public information space. There is traditional media. Secondly, there are corporate communications. Corporate communications including, although it's not fair to many corporate communications, but including public relations. So corporate communications, this is an expanding area. In most countries of the world, more people are being employed in public relations and in corporate communications than in straightforward journalism. The journalism schools are full of young people who want to be something in the media, but when they come out, there are no jobs. Where do these talented people go? They go into corporate communications or they go into the political sphere, where political parties now are part of the process of generating public information. So the stories that are not being produced by journalists are being produced for them by corporate communications. A friend of mine, Nick Davis, produced a book a few years ago called Flat Earth News, in which he revealed that 54% of the information being published by national newspapers in the United Kingdom had been prepared and pre-cooked by public relations companies and corporate communicators. Not by journalists making these sort of clear decisions, but actually by a sort of completely different sector. So we have a situation where corporations, governments take their messages directly to the public, leaving over journalism and so on. So this creates a serious issue for us in terms of how we maintain and protect our democracy. How do we begin to build a new approach which embraces the need for change but begins to rekindle a real understanding about the role and responsibility of media and journalism in society? That is the sort of task that we are seeking to look at. And what we're doing is looking at these sorts of questions. And it's important to say that these are questions which are not coming from the academic community. These are questions which are coming from inside journalism. This is what we are seeking to do. First of all, rethinking acts of journalism and who is a journalist. It is true that journalism can no longer be defined according to who employs you, whether or not you carry a union card, or whether or not you've got a diploma from a legitimate journalism school. It's true. The fact of the matter is, ordinary people, ordinary citizens can, if they want, and have the right, commit themselves to doing work which they put into the information space and say, I want this to be taken seriously. Is Edward Snowden a journalist? He never qualified as a journalist. He never worked for a journalistic institution. But the work he's doing and the way that he's doing it is very much journalistic in terms of his contribution to opening up, making politics more transparent, society more transparent, and so on. So we have to recognize that acts of journalism need to be protected. Need to be protected as much as we protect and value the correspondent or the well-qualified professional. We also need to rebuild the ethical base of journalism. We need to get a recognition inside the media pyramid that ethics count, and it's not just at the bottom of the media pyramid. Whenever we have a debate about journalism, it's always the problem about how do we get ethics from the people at the bottom. To say the ordinary journalists or the filmmakers and so on. And I think the activities of media in the United Kingdom over the past couple of years have sort of really revealed that when that goes wrong, there are some serious problems. is inevitable that the whole culture of that organization is actually going to be corroded and so on. So that need for rebuilding the ethical base of journalism from the top to the bottom is absolutely fundamental. Thirdly, the question of self-censorship. Self-censorship is the process where journalism is driven by fear. That is to say, we publish this because we're afraid to publish that. I write this because there will be terrible consequences if I write that. That's self-censorship. It is not professional judgment freely applied. It is people acting in their own best self-interest. One of the problems, and one of the criticisms I think there has been in Hungary, or of Hungary, in recent years, has been the changes to media policy and law, which have created a great deal of consternation around Europe, have generated an atmosphere that has been conducive to self-censorship inside journalism. I mean, a couple of years ago, maybe it was a bit strong to say that the creation of the separate agreements that were made between the Media Council and various associations of media in order to have self-regulation was a form of outsourcing censorship. I think it would be a better way to describe it as a form of outsourcing self-censorship. Because I think one of the things about it is that an atmosphere was created which was creating fear, fearfulness. And when media operate in a state of fearfulness, it's inevitable that you have self-censorship. So whatever regulatory framework we have, it must be a framework which encourages the best qualities of professionalism, openness and transparency, and really removes self-censorship at all, or altogether. But fourthly, there's the question of partnership with the audience. The days of the elite, the media elite, are long gone. It's no longer the case that powerful editors and journalists and so on have themselves, for themselves, the capacity to control the media agenda and basically to tell the audience what's good for them. Now, the audience is part of the process. And that engagement and partnership with the audience means we have to have a new debate, a new dialogue with civil society and so on. So we need good governance and we need self-regulation. That self-regulation has to be dealt with at two levels. One is we need a new debate on internal company level self-regulation. I take the view that national structures for self-regulation or national structures for regulation, whether it's a media council or it's a self-regulating council, actually are neither here nor there. Important, but they're only important if you've got respect for values at enterprise level. They are only going to work and have credibility if media companies themselves have developed their mission statement, their code of conduct, their good governance rules, their commitment to transparency, published guidelines, access, responding to the concerns and complaints of the audience. We've been working on issues like this in countries like Egypt and Tunisia, where they are in the process of creating democracy. And also countries like Pakistan and Turkey, where these issues are a big debate. But this question of internal, company level, enterprise commitment is very important. And then we have the external national structures, industry-wide systems of self-regulation. Then the question is, in a converged media environment, should these structures of regulation be voluntary, such as the tradition in the press, or legally defined, such as the tradition in audiovisual sector, in the broadcasting sector. In a converged media environment, we have the situation where a journalist could and can work on a story in the morning for online, or even for print, and work on the same story in the afternoon for video transmission. They may be covered, actually, in many countries, by two different forms of regulation of that same content. One is voluntary, self-regulation through the press, and one might be statutory, which is the regulation defined by broadcasting. This is an untenable state of affairs in a converged media environment. So what is the future? The future, it seems, is sensible. A future that says journalism and journalistic content, no matter which platform it is disseminated upon, should be subject to the same consistent self-regulatory framework. So that there is no division between the morning and afternoon shift in a particular media house. There has to be some sort of sanity in the way media regulation for the future. So I'm really of the view that we have to be very, very clear that there is no easy answer, and we need to have a new dialogue about new national structures. Above all, whatever structures we begin to look at, which need to, I think legal underpinning is not as threatening as has been given the impression in the United Kingdom. But legal underpinning has to be sort of very narrowly defined. It has to be very, very clear that it's actually relating to very sort of special conditions in which the structure of self-regulation takes place. You have legal underpinning in Denmark, you have legal underpinning in Ireland, and these actually work quite well as forms of co-regulation because they are based upon the principle of self-regulation. So we need to look at that question of how we self-regulate, but in the self-regulatory process, we also have to get back to our friends in the audience and recognise that there is a responsibility for public representation and so on. So my final words really are these. We have to recognise the difference between journalism and free speech. That's the starting point. If we want to get respect for journalistic work, see its importance in the context of building democracy, we have to recognise that it's different from free speech. And that is absolutely fundamental to understanding how we move forward. Secondly, we have to review the dual system for broadcast and print online regulation. Most press councils in Europe now, most of them, already do and include all forms of journalistic content in their area of self-regulatory jurisdiction. That's extremely important because it's recognition within the industry that we cannot continue with obsolete and conflicting forms of regulation. Thirdly, supporting the voluntary principle. The voluntary principle, it seems to me, is not just important because it appeals to the best instincts that are in everybody who's working in journalism and media, but because the voluntary principle is essentially at its heart a democratic principle. It's built upon the notion of building consensus around values which we need to have in democracy. And fourthly, we need to invest in creating a responsible public information landscape. We had a bit of a discussion earlier this morning about that. That certainly means we've got to find more money for good journalism. We've got to find more money for good media literacy campaigns. We've got to engage with our audience and our potential audience. We've got to talk to young people, talk to school children. We've got to find ways of bringing in the whole of society at all levels into a new sense of everyone has to be responsible for the public information landscape. And we have to have meetings like this constantly and developed and repetitively, because we have to take this debate beyond charm circle, and you are part of a charm circle, of policymakers, or media professionals, or lawyers, or people who are deeply concerned about these issues. We have to take it into the heart of our societies in order to be able to really understand what needs to be done, and to bring in the reality that many of us are ignoring, which is that if we're going to have a good future for journalism and democracy, have to make sure that everyone is aware of the changes that are taking place and what their responsibilities are. When we begin to do that, I think we will make progress. My little and my colleagues like Bash and so on who are working in the Ethical Journalism Network are trying to create, and to a certain extent is beginning to move forward, trying to create a well of opinion inside media and journalism that they have to provide more leadership in this. What we heard this morning was extremely depressing. The fact that there is not enough solidarity between media organisations and media professionals here in Hungary. I have to tell you, that is the same in many other parts of Europe. We have a real problem to build professionalism and media solidarity. But one of the ways we can begin to confront that is to ensure that media leaders, media professionals are invited to take part in these discussions. And the more they are, I don't think we're going to be able to make progress. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. White, for this truly fascinating intervention. I think this will give us some food for thought for the next 1 hour. And I would like to pick up where Mr. White gives us some directions in this respect. So we will also talk about that in the later part of our today's panel discussion. But before that, I would like to ask Mr. Bharata, because you have a lot of on the spot, on the field experience about the issues that Mr. Ingman raised. So how do you see these issues that he mentioned, with, especially with regard to self-censorship, and as Ms. Miyatovic likes to call it, the chilling effect that is in place sometimes, not only in Europe, but in Central Asia, parts that you are, that the OSCE is very active. Thank you.
Thank you. So, yeah, I mean, this is a very, very important and relevant matter, the matter of self-censorship and chilling effect, as you mentioned. This is closely related to something that we discussed last week in the panels that were organized as well by the Hungarian Media Authority, which refers to the idea of proportionality. When regulation is not proportionate, then you have a big risk of creating a chilling effect. I think that this is an important, this I think the most important idea. And of course, I mean, when you take a look at audiovisual media regulation, the issue of proportionality becomes particularly tricky to analyze to what extent something is proportionate or disproportionate. What I would say is that at this present time, content regulation in the field of audiovisual media services has become less and less important, whereas the most important part, I think, has to do with structural regulation. I think that the regulator, in a context of diversity, in a context of, let's say, an increasing number of voices, has a particular remit in the field of making sure that the structure of the public sphere is really diverse. And because an increasing of the number of voices doesn't necessarily lead to an increase of the diversity of the public sphere. So I think that a major theme here, apart from, let's say, the basic content regulations in the field of protection of minors, regulation of hate speech, so on and so forth, here the most important focus should be put on structural regulation, protecting pluralism, making sure that the public sphere, despite the fact I insist that there's a very huge number of media outlets, to make sure that it's not being dominated by one single point of view or by one single concentrated company. Also to make sure that the public service media are really present in this new context. And there's another thing that is quite related to this idea of proportionality, which is the important role of intermediaries. It has been mentioned by Mr. Wang, the fact that now we are witnessing, let's say, a process in which the, let's say, the value chain has become more and more and more complex, so that the original creator of content is less reachable by the regulator. And the regulator can have the temptation to try to regulate the intermediaries in a way that could be disproportionate, that could lead to self-censorship, and in particular that could lead to something that we can call private censorship. If you put a strict onus of responsibility, of liability on intermediaries that are serving, that are providing content, well, the outcome of that could be that these intermediaries, they don't want to get in trouble, so that they regulate, they restrict what they are offering. And I'm thinking of this current debate about comments on newspapers, I'd say on the website of newspapers or media outlets. To what extent, the owner of the website can be held responsible for some comment that has been posted on the website. And of course, the immediate temptation that we have a very recent decision of the European Court of Human Rights that refers to these, is to put, I mean, to make things easy, and to say that the owner of the website is responsible for everything that is being posted. But we we have to think in terms of danger, self-censorship, right censorship, that this situation can bring. And the truth is that the audiovisual media, I mean, this is related to what you were mentioning before, the Audiovisual Media Service Directive up to now is not able to really tackle these issues because, I mean, the scope has been widened, that's right, I mean, and now it includes linear and non-linear services, but at the same time, the discussion about what is television like, which is the wording of the directive, I think that it has been outdated, and as Mr. White mentioned, a new reflection on digital media and how we deal with digital media and how we regulate this digital media as a whole is something that has to be put on the table, and I think that the European Commission has just begun to think about it.
Thank you very much, Mr. Baratam. I would also like to pose a question to receive some on the in this changing media environment, changing media ecosystem, as you often refer to. What role would you assign to the regulatory authorities? What are the new novelties of this role compared to the ones that we encountered, for example, 10 years ago? Because as Mr. Baratta mentioned, we are the Audiovisual Services Directive is not legally covering this area, so or it's lagging behind in some respects. So I would like to know whether this has any bearing on the activity of a modern regulator. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that already we're seeing that modern audiovisual regulators are less concerned with content issues than they were 10 years ago, when certainly all around Europe regulatory authorities spent an awful lot of time monitoring the two or three television stations that were broadcasting and checking everything that went out. That doesn't happen anymore. Now that we're in a multi-channel world. And I think with convergence and figures from around Europe are showing this, that particularly young people are watching more and more audiovisual content online. The latest figures from 2012 in the UK from Ofcom show that 55% of under 25-year-olds watch audiovisual content online. Internet-enabled device. So we're moving into a very, very different world, and regulators need to shift their emphasis to keep up with this. So I think, as Mr. Baratta said, the emphasis for regulation is going to be on infrastructure and structural regulation, looking at ensuring that there's adequate plurality. This is a huge challenge for regulators. Many regulatory authorities in countries like the European Commission are beginning to think about how you can regulate for plurality in terms of taking into account online bias as well as more traditional media. But that would be one matter for regulators to be concerned with. Another big issue is access. keynote speaker, which we shouldn't overlook. I think there's a very significant role for regulatory authorities in promoting media literacy, as although our children might be growing up knowing how to navigate in this new environment, anyone over the age of 40 struggles with it. And I think that there's a real role for broadcasters, broadcasting and media regulators, to help citizens understand the consequences of this information revolution that we're living through.
Thank you very much. And at this point, I cannot fail to mention that our regulatory authority established a media literacy center. It's a cutting edge center, really very nice. So all of those who are interested should take a look. It's in the Buda area of Budapest, and it focuses on media literacy issues for minors. So it's really interesting.
Yeah. Very briefly on regulators here, the matter of convergence. We have also a problem and the big discussion about the convergence of regulators, which is a very, very important issue, because as the value chain for the provision of audiovisual media services has become more and more and more complicated, and we have more actors that have been incorporated to this value chain, the problem for regulators is that basically traditional broadcasting regulators were basically used to deal with traditional broadcasters. And in some cases, some of the problems that are typical of the business problem, for example, plural protection of pluralism, granting access, etc., etc., can only be solved dealing with, not with broadcasters, but dealing with other parts of the value chain that are not, let's say, used to be regulated and to deal with the regulator. So basically, I don't know if we need just one single regulator or a group of regulators, but we need a regulator that is strong enough to, deal with all these new actors. Some of them are very powerful, to make them understand that regulation is important and they have to be regulated. Think, for example, of connected TV. Now we have device manufacturers that can become the object of a regulatory intervention, which is something that it was impossible to imagine in the past. But now, probably with some of the problems in terms of pluralism will be caused by these device manufacturers, because on your screen they only offer you 10 options, 10 main options, so they are precluding your access to other, for example. So unless the regulator is able to intervene vis-a-vis these new actors, the problem will not be solved. So I think that regulators should be strong, and at least the approach this issue by different eventual regulators at least should be consistent. Otherwise, it will be impossible to deal with these new problems. Sorry.
Thank you. Mr. Barotta, as the English saying goes, you are preaching to the converted, because this is a truly converged regulator, the Hungarians. It's the second one in Central Europe after the Slovenian regulator. So we are regulating the whole audiovisual section in Hungary, of course, in different layers and in different manners, but truly convergence is already in full swing in Hungary. So thank you very much for your intervention. And szeretném most Láncos Petrának adni a szót, akit arról fogok kérdezni, hogy szerinte merre halad az európai média szabályozás. Ha megnézzük, milyen a sajtószabadság kérdését, illetve az egyéb kérdéseként, tehát ő mire számít, hogy milyen tendenciák lesznek a jövőben ezzel kapcsolatban. fontos feladattal, hogy az EU-s jogalkotásnál olyan tanácsokat adjon az Európai Bizottságnak, ami egy olyan új irányelvet hoz létre, ami megfelel a szabályozó hatóságok közötti együttműködés követelményeinek. Most is az irányelv bevezetőjének 95. pontja egy ilyen erős együttműködésre hív fel a szabályozó hatóságok között, ez sokszor nem valósul meg. Ezt mi például a saját bőrünkön érezzük, amikor például olyan hatóságokkal kommunikálunk, akik nem vevők a mi panaszainkra, most nem szeretnék itt egyet sem kiragadni, de reméljük, hogy ez az új csoport erre is választ ad. Ugye Petra említette a sokszínűség kérdését, illetve ezzel kapcsolatos felvetéseket, és szeretném megkérdezni Vejer Balázs, hogy szerintem mennyire sokszínű a magyar médiapiac, illetve a magyar média?
A sokszínűség szerintem az a helyzet, hogy nem csinálunk mindenhol, hogy én ezeket a régi sokszínűségre vonatkozó érveket, most sok tekintetben ideje tartom, és szerintem ez mellélő a célnak. Pont a digitalizáció miatt szerintem a sokszínűséget, hogyha akarnánk se, lehetne itt fogni, mert nem fenyegeti a sokszínűséget, ez egy más, ez a sokszínűség sem jelentem ennek garanciájaknak, hogy képes lenne betölteni a hivatását a média. Lehet egy nagyon sokszínűen rossz, vagy diszfunkcionális médiapiac is. Itthon is látunk erre példákat, ahogy mondtam, két pártos napilap összevetéséből sose lesz egy pártatlan eredő, tehát hogy két hazugságban nem lehet összerakni a tehát ilyen a sokszínűség nem garancia arra, hogy a társadalom tájékozott legyen, hogy a társadalom felkészült legyen az ügyét, a legfontosabb döntések meghozatalára. Tehát nem a sokszínűséget tartom ebben az értelemben a kulcsnak. A sokszínűség az nem jelent minőséget, a sokszínűség nem jelent függetlenséget. A sokszínűség rendkívül fontos volt, szerintem egy első, amivel a 90-es években nálunk, az egy fontos szempont, tehát közvetlen rendszerváltás következik. Nyilván ez volt a legfontosabb tenni való a médiapiacon, de már sem nálunk, sem máshol, legalábbis a demokratikus rendszerek működnek. Nem ez a lényeg. Vannak olyan területek elsősorban a nagyon korlátozott hozzáféréssel rendelkező a digitális szakadéktól és a média tudatosságnak legalacsonyabb szintjén.
Köszönöm szépen, hogy tényleg, és most ugye még András, Boltai András nem szólalt meg, de őt pedig arról szeretném megkérdezni, ugye szabályozásról beszéltünk itt, hogy az 1996. egyes törvény, ugye a rádiózásról és televíziózásról majdnem 14 évet megélt, tehát addig volt hatályban, hogy szeretném megkérdezni, hogy médiatanács tani szemmel, vagy szabályozói szemmel ez az új törvény, ami 2010-ben fogadott el a parlament, megérne hasonlóan szép kort, és egyáltalán lehetséges-e ma olyan törvényt alkotni az audiovizuális, illetve a média szektorban, ami ilyen nagy időt lefed, illetve milyen gyakran kell majd hozzányúlni szerinte?
Köszönöm a kijelölt kérdést. Azt gondolom, hogy a média törvényeket nem az örökké valóságnak írják, de hogy pontosan eddig maradt hatályban egy, az mindig bizonytalan, hogy a 96 évi egyesről sem gondolta senki, hogy 15 évig hatályos lesz, és nyilván sok tényező függvénye az, hogy a jelenlegi meddig maradt hatályban. Amit el lehet mondani, kapcsolódva az elhangzottakhoz, hogy a hatályos törvény bizonyos tekintetben már kimerészkedett azokra a területekre, ahol amelyekre ugye a technológia fejlődése ráirányította a figyelmet. Nyilván vita tárgya vitatható is, hogy ez a kimerészkedés ez mennyire volt indokolt, mennyire volt szükséges a tekintetben az elmúlt években éles hangú viták folytak, de hogy az internet fölvett szabályozási kérdéseket, az nyilván nem vitatható. Amit viszont a törvény nem tudott lekezelni, és valószínűleg nem is volt időszerű, hogy ezeket lekezelje, de azok az új szolgáltatások, illetve azok az új problémák, amelyek itt időről időre a mai nap folyamán is előkerültek, például a Connected TV kapcsán. Azért gondolom, hogy ez nem időszerű ennek a szabályozása, mert egyelőre mindig csak a problémát kerülgetjük Európa szerte, és igazából jogi, jogalkotói válaszok ezekre a kérdésekre nem születnek. Nekem is inkább csak kérdéseim lennének, illetve várnám a panel vagy a közönség soraiból érkező észrevételeket. Olyan kérdései merülnek föl, amelyek akár etikai szabályozásról, tehát egyfajta önszabályozásról, vagy magánszabályozásról beszélünk, akár jogi szabályozásról beszélünk, egyaránt felmerülnek. Egyrészt a sokszínűség vita, pluralizmus vita, egy örök újcsontja az európai média szabályozásnak. Beszélünk róla, de nem feltétlenül tudjuk, hogy micsoda is pontosan. Itt például már is egyfajta érdekes ellentmondás, vagy egyfajta feszültséget véltem felfedezni abban, amit minden már mondott, és abban, amit Beyer Balázs mondott, mert ugyan igaz az nyilvánvalóan, hogy az internet és az új digitális szolgáltatások korábban egy bizonyos értelemben látszólagos, vagy bizonyos értelemben nem fejti ki azt a hatást, amit az internethez reményként, ugye minden ezzel foglalkozó kutató hozzá fűzött, hogy ugye itt jön el majd a demokratikus véleménynyilvánítás korszaka. Mindenki elmutatja magáit, de nem mindenkire fognak odafigyelni, és számomra ez egy jelentős különbség. A másik, ami itt egy nagyon fontos gondolató délelőtt is, és most is, hogy olyan új szereplők léptek be a média piacra, szokás az értékláncba, akik a szabályzás hatája alá nem tartoznak, és nem is eldöntött jelen pillanatban, hogy oda kell, hogy tartozzanak, vagy nem. Valószínűleg, hogyha ők már fenyegetik a véleményszabadságot és a sokszínűséget, akkor valamilyen szabályzási megoldást erre előbb-utóbb találni kell. És ez megint egy olyan probléma, ami mind etikai, mind jogi eszköz. Mindezek elővetítik azt a problémát, ami szintén többször előkerült már, hogy kié a felelősség a médiapiacon. Itt a kommentekről tett említést Barata úr, nemrégiben hozott a strasbourgi bíróság ezzel kapcsolatban egy döntést, amit sokan vitatnak, a magyar bíróságok is hoznak ezekkel kapcsolatos döntéseket, azokat a döntéseket is sokan vitatják. Egy dolog nem tisztázott, hogy kinek kell viselni a felelősséget a jogsértő tartalmakért. Azt gondoljuk-e, hogy ezek a tartalmak az internet sajátosságára tekintettel immár jogsértők, és akkor a Gordiuszi csomó át van vágva. Ezáltal lemondunk a korábban értelmezett személyiségi jogok korábbi hagyományos értelmezéséről, hogy azt mondjuk, hogy jogsértő, de akkor meg kell mondjuk, érte, az anonim és beazonosíthatatlan kommentelő, vagy az a médium, aki ezt közé tette, erre nincsenek mindenki által elfogadott válaszok, de a jogi felelősséget feltételezve, hogy tovább visszük a személyiségjogok hagyományos európai értelmezését, valahová érdemes elérni. És ugyanez a probléma, egy hasonló probléma merül fel, ezzel összefüggő probléma merül fel, amiről itt György is említést tett, ugye a különböző normarendszereknek a léte, még európai szinten is, egy olyan kérdésben, amiben látszólag teljes a konszenzus a gyermekvédelem kapcsán, gyermekeket védeni kell a káros tartalomtól, egész más típusú tartalmat ítélnek károsnak Észak-Európában, Dél-Európában, Nyugaton, Keleten, miközben az irányelv ugyanazokat a szavakat mondja és teszi kötelező minden állam számára, hogy implementálja, ez a gyakorlatban mégis egészen mást és mást jelent. Tehát mindezen összefüggő gondolatunknak az a lég, hogy az új jövő média szabályozás azért megítélésem szerint nem tud tisztán nemzeti szabályozás lenni, hogy nem
hogy a média rendszereket, az országok média rendszerét felügyelő testületek és az azokkal dolgozó hatóságok, apparátusok, azok megfelelő módon tükrözzék az országok pluralitását, a társadalmak sokszínűségét, és itt én nem értek egyet azzal, ami elhozott az európai jog vonatkozásában, hogy az Unióban ne lenne közös uniós lehetőség arra, hogy valamiféle föderális szabályozást alkossunk arra nézve, hogy minden tagállamban követelmény legyen az, hogy a média testületek azok a társadalmak sokszínűségét tükrözzék. És tehát vagy csak úgy folytatom a gondolat, hogy biztos pontosan is befejezem itt már, nyilván vannak más kérdések is. So my question to the panel is that would you agree that in the European Union basically we very much need a common sort of federalist binding requirement for member states, which binding requirement would provide that each member state is obliged by mandatory and foreseeable common European fundamental regulation to create safeguards that no any governing majority or any other social group in any of the societies of the European Union or member states countries can create media councils which are sort of reflecting only one group, political, economic, cultural or other group in their composition, by their members, but each member state would be obliged to create pluralistic bodies, because that sort of seems to be an obviously necessary precondition of creating, sustaining, safeguarding pluralistic media in all member states. And by the way, there is the European Initiative, Citizen Initiative for Media Pluralism, and that one of the aim of these initiations is to create such mandatory regulation. So the question is whether you would agree we need that, and if you disagree, please specify whether you disagree because you think that it should be up for each EU member state, whether the member state, the specific member state, let its governing majority of the day in its economic groups, its social groups, whatever social group, to dominate the media supervisory system and through that the whole media system in a country, or you disagree with the necessity, with the proposal for the necessity of such binding regulation on the basis of kind of state power approach, sort of like you disagree because you deny that the sort of federalist structure in the EU can go deep enough to include a mandatory rule to safeguard this fundamental value. But if you escape the fundamental question by pushing an anti-federalist point, then please still respond to what do you think about the necessary safeguards for pluralistic media councils in the European Union. Whether it's a fundamental value in our European Union, or it's just the hobby of some of us who take press freedom seriously. Thanks.
Let me start to respond to that question. I'm sure others will have their say. I think on your fundamental question about the makeup, the constitution of media authorities, I'm here actually representing the Council of Europe. I'm an expert for the Council of Europe. And the Council of Europe has very clear normative standards that apply to all member states. That say that media regulatory authorities should be independent. They should be independent of both political and commercial influence. Now, the definition of independence is, you know, pretty clear, but how you actually create an independent authority is very different from country to country. The whole concept of independence can be very difficult in countries that are particularly those which are relatively new democracies and don't have a very long history of democratic institutions. But I think one thing is sure, that the concept of independence is not consistent with the concept of an authority that reflects a democratically elected government. That they're separate. I mean, there's some people who say we live in a democracy, we elect our government according to democratic principles, and therefore our regulatory authorities should reflect our democratically elected government. And that's not what independence means. Independence carries with it a concept of being apart from political allegiances. And that's why it's very, very difficult in so many countries to find competent, skilled people who can serve on a regulatory authority but do not bring with them any political mandate. How you go about finding such people and selecting them to serve on regulatory authorities, and it's not just the media authority, the other regulatory authorities as well that ought to consist of independent people. But it's a challenge, and there is no single right way, and the way of creating independent authorities changes over time. But that's a challenge. That's a challenge to Hungary, it's a challenge to every single member state, not just in the EU, but wider in the Council of Europe. So that's how I answer that question.
Okay, you mentioned several things. One, you made a short reference to this adjective, strong regulator, and I want to come back to this because I don't want it to be misinterpreted. I mean by strong regulator, I meant a regulator that is able to deal with this new complex and more diverse value chain. And a regulator that is able to deal with broadcasters, but is able to deal with telecom companies, intermediaries, etc. So, the competence is a little bit wide. This is what I meant by strong regulator. The other thing, I think it's more relevant. You mentioned two main issues. The first one is diversity promoted by the regulator, and the other one is diversity within the regulator, so to speak. These are two different problems. The first one, well, this is a discussion that has been going on in Europe for years and decades. You know that at the EU level it has been possible to agree on certain basic principles for the regulation of content, protection of minors, protection of human dignity, even if these principles were somewhat general, and then it's up to member states to kind of develop in their domestic legal systems these principles, but it's something that was agreed at the level of Brussels, whereas it's been impossible to agree on a common definition of diversity and pluralism at the level of the EU, because you know that the EU is so diverse that it includes countries as different as Sweden and Italy. So, and probably the idea of pluralism that exists in Italy, or wants, that the Italian government wants to promote, is completely different from the idea of diversity that exists in Finland, for example. So this is why it's been really difficult, even if now we have to acknowledge that the European Commission is working hard, trying to find a common approach in the area of pluralism, a common approach that goes beyond protection of competition. Assuming that these are two things that are different. One thing is promoting and fostering a diverse and competitive market, and another thing is different and it's complementary to that, is promoting a market that, apart from being competitive, is diverse enough in order to allow the free formation of the public opinion. Because in some cases you have markets that are concentrated from the point of view of pluralism, but which are not concentrated from the point of view of competition. Until now, the European Commission has been able to intervene in the audiovisual market using the tools, the typical tools of competition law. but not a common approach in the field of protection of pluralism. But there's some work, some discussions going on in this other area. I think that, of course, we have to acknowledge that freedom of expression, pluralism, are things that are closely linked to national constitutions and national values, but at the same time they have to be put as well at the level of, let's say, the European constitutional norms. And so I think that it's important to make an effort in this sense, even if, of course, it's much more difficult to reach a common understanding than to have a common regulator in the field of telecom than in the field of audiovisual media. This is obvious, quite an obvious thing. Finally, diversity within the regulator. Well, this is something that, as a lawyer, I can tell you that, I mean, it's impossible by law, simply by law, to guarantee independence of the regulator. You can have a perfect law, I mean, at least on the paper, that does not guarantee at all. Because in practice, the lack of democratic maturity of the country or other factors that may intervene basically impede the real independence of the regulator. So apart from a legal issue, apart from a legal issue that requires the existence of certain international standards, it's also a matter of democratic culture. And this is something that belongs to each country, of course. Another thing that it has already been said by Yves, is that we already have some important standards, not at the level of the EU, because at the level of the EU, the issue of regulatory authorities, it has always been controversial, basically because of Spain, my country, because in Spain we don't have an independent regulatory authority. Well, now we have it, but this is quite recent. So Spain was blocking all the time any regulation at the EU level in order to regulate, to establish the existence of independent regulators, but at the level of the Council of Europe, I think that the standards are quite clear in terms of what is independence and how independence should be preserved, etc., etc. Another thing is that within the Council of Europe, countries do not really respect the standards that have been set by the Council of Europe. That's another matter. And I have to remind that the Council of Europe does not only prevent one single party, for example, or the government, to occupy or to control the regulatory authority. It is also against the principles of the Council of Europe to reproduce at the level of the regulator the, let's say, the structure of the parliament. This is something that, because it's, again, we will have there a problem of independence. We have three of the majority, two of the minority, and then one that belongs to this political party, because then what you have is something that the Italians call lotizzazione, which basically means you make packages and you distribute the power, and basically you reach, with this system, it's very simple to unanimously elect all the members of the regulatory authority. We reach an agreement between all the different political parties, I vote your candidates, you vote my candidates, and end of the story. So, the important thing is not this distribution of power, it's not reproducing the forces of the parliament at the level of the regulatory authority, it's not giving the regulatory authority as the prize for the winner of the elections, it's about safeguarding the election of real independent people. We all have official affiliations, but some people are able to be independent and others are not. Some people know about audiovisual regulation, others don't know about that. So it's important to have transparent systems for the election of the members of the council, accountability, citizens, surveillance of these processes, so on and so forth. But I mean, it's impossible to elaborate or to suggest a specific formula, because I insist, I'm afraid, that law is not enough in this area.
Az Európai Uniónak lenne rá hatásköre. Az Európai Polgár
to the Audiovisual Media Services Directive, there is a reference to media regulators being independent. So although it's not part of the directive, so it's a reference to the directive.
Európai hatóság ugye feladat körébe tartozik, hogy foglalkozna szerzői jogi kérdésekkel, és emlékszem az Európa
ez a Koreában. Van Európában egy ország, ahol a médiahatóság tagjait egyetlen egy párt delegálta, ilyen szempontból ez nem plurális. Ez a médiahatóság egyetértett azzal, hogy a nemzeti hírügynökség hiányi legyenek ingyenesek. Ezzel a döntéssel áttételesen lehetővé tette, hogy minden más hírügynökség életképtelenné váljon. Az egyetlen hírügynökség, amelynek a hírei ingyenesek, naponta dönt arról, hogy miről ad hírt. Nem visszamenőleg törni el a múltat, hanem ma dönti el, hogy mi lehet ott. Ebben a hírügynökségi gyakorlatban belefért, hogy azt a köztársasági elnököt, aki néhány évvel ezelőtt még az ország alapokmányos értékrendszerének a személyes szimbóluma volt, úgy szerepeltessék, mintha nem is lenne. A kérdés az, hogy az egyébként nagyon disztikált és nagyon szofisztikált európai szabályozás részletes erdője alatt mifajta gyakorlatok nyernek elismerést és minősülnek az európai normarendszere belül.
És esetleg még, hát ha nem, akkor szeretném lezárni ezt a délutáni ülést, szeretném mindenkinek megköszönni a részvételt, és szeretném megköszönni külföldi vendégeinknek, hogy eljöttek ide, és részt vettek ezen az ülésen. Ez a konferencia, az együttműködésünk az Európa Tanáccsal nem ért véget, jövőre folytatni fogjuk, és örülünk, hogy ma ennyien itt voltunk, és tényleg nagyon érdekes témákról, beszélgetéseket folytattuk, és szeretnénk a legközelebb találkozni.